Okay, today we are going to see the standards, different standards for library automation. So I'm not going to take each and every standard because in our syllabus we are having MARC, CCF, Dublin Core. So we will cover that over the due course of time. So one important standard you need to know about is ISO 2709. Okay, that is one of the important standard used for exchanging information in simple terms, right? It is used for interchange of information, exchanging information, right? So we will see what this standard is all about, right? So before going into that, you need to know what is ISO actually. ISO is nothing but it is an international organization for standardization. Okay, what do you mean by standardization? So there should be specific standards set so that the rules and regulations can be followed, can be transferred to another set, another company or something like that. If for example, I will give you a simple example with the library science. If the syllabus of MLIS is same in all the universities, the knowledge, the wherever you go and study, and wherever after completing the MLIS, most of the students will have the same set of knowledge. If the syllabus, one school is having high syllabus and one department is having low syllabus, means there is no proper standard, right? Okay, there is no proper standard. That means one school, the students graduating from high standard syllabus will have more knowledge, and student graduating from low standard syllabus will have low knowledge. So standard is all about uniformity. There should be uniformity. So in library, the records, the bibliographical records, if they are of uniform nature, it is easy to transfer. Simple as that, right? So IS 2709 is an international format, not only national, it is used global all over the world for information interchange, right? For exchange of bibliographical details of a record, right? A single library cannot purchase all the books, right? So as I said earlier, if the standard is same, I can directly import the record from your library instead of doing cataloging manually and type each record. If I'm using this same standard as your library, I can just import it within a second. So it is used for exchange of bibliographical record or exchange of information, this particular standard. It is the world's largest developer and publisher of international standards, ISO. Okay, it gives world-class specification for every product. There is an ISO standard, you can see. So this should be the standard, the size should be this, the width should be this, the height should be this. So ISO decides the standards for different products, services, systems, and whatever it may be, right? To ensure quality, safety, and efficiency, right? Quality of the product should be there, okay? And it should also be safe to use, and it should also be efficient. So these are the principles of ISO in determining the standards, right? So it standards makes things work. They are instrumental in facilitating international trade. If standard is there, if everyone follows the same standard, it is easy. It is easy to convey. Simple as that. So history and development. So I'm not going detail into this historical part, right? So everywhere when you take a particular concept, everywhere there will be history. Simple. So 1946 is started from 1946, where delegates from 25 countries and came and met in London to decide and create a new international organization. The objective of that particular meeting was to facilitate international coordination and unification of industrial standards. To facilitate coordination and unification, there should be uniformity and coordination between different standards of different industrial standards. Every country's before that, every country was using their own specification. So after this, they standardized the products in a uniform way to exchange it and for exchanging it and identifying it purpose, right? So from based on the minutes of the meeting, that ISO eventually began and fully operated from 1947. The headquarters of ISO is Geneva, Switzerland. Sometimes these questions are asked in net examination. So just for those sake, you can remember that 1947, Geneva, Switzerland. So what are standards? As I already mentioned, you see, it is a technical document designed to be used as a rule, guideline, or definition. Standard is a technical document. Okay, this defines a rule. So this, for example, plastic bottle, it should have this much width, this much size, whatever it may be. So there is a standard for a plastic bottle. So chair, or a char, a wooden char. So it should have this much thickness. It should made of this wood only, like that. Simple. So whatever technical rule, whatever technical rule and specifications they give, that is a standard document. Simple as that. It is consciousness built. Consciousness built means it's based on the opinion of everyone, not only a single mind. It is a thought process of and the views of different people. That is consciousness. You will learn this about in Delphi method. Okay, a repeatable way for doing something. A standard is an agreed way. If there is a standard, means it is agreed all over the world. Simple as that, right? So how does ISO develop standards? It is developed by a panel of experts. There is a panel of experts who evaluate the product or service or whatever it may be with a technical committee, right? Within a technical committee. Once the need for standard has been established, the experts meet to discuss and negotiate a draft standard. So they determined, so these should be the standard for this particular product. Let's take a plastic bottle or water, glass bottle, whatever. So these are the standards. The height is like this, the width is like this, or whatever it may be. And as soon after that, they will create a draft. Okay, as soon as the draft has been developed, it is shared with the members who are asked to comment and vote on it. So the draft, internal draft, will be circulated. The set of rules, right? Before the final rules, they will set a draft rules. Okay, based on the draft, the draft will be circulated to all the members of ISO, and they can express their thoughts and share their comments. No, this you can remove it, this you can add it. So this is good, like that. If a consciousness in the sense that everyone agrees, okay, reach the draft becomes an ISO standard. Simple. If everyone agrees to that particular set of rules, then the draft will be finally published as a ISO standard. If they are not agreeing, again it goes back to the technical committee for editing further. So this is the procedure ISO follows to develop a standard for a particular product or a service or whatever it may be, right? So what is a standard organization? A standard organization is an organization whose primary activities are developing, coordinating, promulgating, revising, amending, reissuing, interpreting, or otherwise producing technical standards that are intended to address the need of some relatively wide base of affected adopters. Simple as that, right? A standard organization provides the need for developing uniformity, revising, interpreting. So this should be, they are the authorized agency to fix a set of rules for a particular product or particular service, right? So that is simple. Don't confuse with this technical definitions. The standard organization or the organization, they provide the rules. And ISO is for international level, right? So in India, there is a standard body called standard organization called BIS, Bureau of Indian Standards. So they determine the standard for Indian scenario. Okay, you can go through that standards. Okay, fine. So as I told you, the standardization process, right? That is a process involved. The committee will meet together. They form a draft, and based on the draft, they will send it to the members, and they get their opinion. And if the opinion consensus is reached, they will publish it as a standard. If not, again they will edit it. Simple. So these are the common terms, acronyms you need to know about the standardization process. PWI. Stands for preliminary work item. So these terms you should remember always, right? It will be useful for you. NP is new proposal. NWIP, new work item proposal. So AWI, approved new work item. PWI is preliminary. AWI is approved. So remember these. WD is a working draft, a draft which is in the working, right? CD is a committee draft. FCD, final committee draft. DIS, draft international standard. FDIS, final draft international standard. So these are the common abbreviation acronyms used. Okay, these are the common acronyms used in the standardization procedure. Okay, if you are familiar with these acronyms, you will know what these are. Every time they won't use the abbreviation, just they will say IS, they will say ISO. Instead of using international standard organization, ISO is easy to use, right? So you should learn about these acronyms. So what is the major purpose of standardization, right? I told you about what is ISO, what is standardization, and what are the procedure of standardization, what are the role of standardized organization. Why standardization is essential? What is the purpose of it? To permit exchange of bibliographical records between group of libraries and abstracting and indexing services. That is the main purpose. To be honest, as I said earlier, I am having a library, I am working as a librarian in a library, you are working as a librarian in a library, right? So, even cataloging, if we follow the same standard, I am purchasing 5,000 books. That 5,000 books you are already having in your library, you are already cataloged in your library, right? So, I have purchased 5,000 books, I am having only one staff. So, to catalog all the 5,000 books, to provide data entry for all the 5,000 books, it will be difficult. So when you are having that and we are using the same software with the same standard, right? I am using Koha, you are using Koha. So Koha follows the same standard everywhere, right? So it will be easy. If the standard is same, it is easy to, I can just send the list of titles to you. You can just provide the cataloging details. We can just interchange using that standards. So to permit exchange, that is the meaning of first point. To permit exchange of bibliographical record between group of libraries, right? So it is easy. I can just within a fraction of within a minute or second, within 5 to 10 minutes, I can import 5,000 records without having the need to enter it manually. So that is the main purpose of standard, to provide uniformity, to permit a bibliographical agency to manipulate bibliographical records received by both libraries. Okay, so there are certain bibliographical agencies, right? So what they do is, if I am a member, if my library is a member of that agency and your library is a member of that agency, for example, I am using Koha, you are using some other software, let it be, no problem. So, and we are a member of the same agency. So when we share our records to that agency will do that work. Okay, they will standardize all the record to a particular standard. Okay, so that we can easily retrieve. Simple as that. If we both are using the same standard, we can share with each other. If not, we are a member of that agency will do that for us. And we can download the records from bibliographical details. We can download the records, bibliographical details from that agency. Simple. To serve as the basis of format for an agency's own database by providing a list of useful data elements to assist the development of individual system. As I said earlier, so that bibliographical agency creates a own database based on the records provided by the member libraries. But in turn, it will be helpful for that individual library. Your library might use Autolib, I might use Koha, some other might use Nirmals. The standards will be different. If the standards are different, if the standards are not same, we go to a bibliographical agency, they will maintain a database of standards to meet the requirement of that particular individual library. Okay, so these are the main purpose of standardization. Okay, standardization is very essential to provide uniformity, simple as that. So ISO 2709 is one of the standards. It is an international format for information interchange. That means you are exchanging information according to an international format, simple. It was developed to exchange of bibliographical record and magnetic tape those days. These records described all forms of material capable of bibliographical description as well as other types of records. Okay, we know what is bibliographical details, right? Simple, I am giving a 4 simple examples. Title of the book, author of the book, edition of the book, publication year. Okay, running title, whatever it may be. Okay, publisher, ISBN. So these kind of information contributes to bibliographical details, right? It describes a generalized structure. So in the first, for example, in one I am keeping title, but in your library one you are keeping it as an author. That means there is no standard, there is no uniformity. And when I just map with just the number one, instead of my title there will be author. So everything get collapsed, right? So the uniform structure, one should be title. Example, I am giving an example. One should be title, two should be author for everything. So if that, I can easily map with those numbers without seeing anything. So one is automatically for title only. Two is automatically for author only. Three is for publisher only. Simple. In case I am typing one as title and you are saving one as author, means when I import records from your library, wherever I have saved it as title field, it will come as author. and everything get collapsed. So that is why that uniformity standard is essential. This ISO 2009 prepares that particular standard, describes a structure, a framework specially for communication between data processing system. They don't communicate via title, author in every detail. They only specify numbers. Okay, they will specify number. One means title, come that simple as that. Two means author, simple. That is a framework. Okay, everywhere. One means we will recognize a title, simple as that. That is a framework designed by ISO 2709. So, bibliographical format and data. So, they are the format used to describe the arrangement or structure of a computer readable record of bibliographical data. So, manually we know it, right? So, in order to exchange the information through computer mode, there should be certain structure. Okay. So, they are designed accordingly. Bibliographical data commonly contain. What does this data contain? Different fields of parasitical, the title, name of author, subject, edition, publication details, ISSN, standard numbers, and whatever other details. So these are the bibliographical data. So again, I am not going into history and development. You just can go through it, because sometimes it will be useful for net examination point of view, right? The latest version is 2709 is 2008. You need to check it, because okay, and the first version is 1973, and you remember the name who developed it also. Okay, sometimes they might ask, this might be useful for your examination, net examination purposes, right? Just go through this. And objectives, again, I'm not going into this because I told you what is the purpose and objective of ISO 2709. The main objective you need to remember is exchange of bibliographical records between group of libraries. That is the main purpose and objective, right? So the structure, now we are coming to the actual structure and the framework, how bibliographical record is designed according to ISO 27009, right? The general structure consists of four major parts. What are they? Record label, directory, data fields, and record separator. These are the four parts of bibliographical record according to ISO 2709. So the record label, this is a basic structure of record label, is the first 24 characteristics of the record is a record label. You won't see any title or something like that, only the numbers, the characters. It includes both numerical value and string value. String is character, it will be in alphabet also on whatever it may be, right? This is the only portion of the record that is fixed in length. That means it contains only 24 values, that is fixed. Okay, right, it includes record length, base address, data contained in the record. It also has elements of data that indicate how many characters are used for indicators and subfield indicators. Okay, when you come to the example, you will know. So what these 24 characters are used for, what are the subfield it used for. So in theory, you will not be able to understand what this record label is actually. When you see a practical description of record label, you will understand what these 24 characters are actually. And the second part is directory. The directory provides the entry position to the fields of the record along with these tags. The directory contains field tags and it provides the entry position. Directory also has four parts, right? And cannot exceed 9 characters in length. Okay, directory also has four parts. It provides tags, the field tags, and the length of a directory is not more than 9 characters. Okay, record label is fixed, only it should contain 24, but directory is not like that. It can be below 9, but not more than 9. Okay, record separator is a single character, only one character. Okay, data field is a string containing all field and sub data field in the record. So in the record we saw what are the subfields and the fields, right? So those comes under data fields. We will see in the example, don't confuse about it, right? And record separator is a single character. It's a single character. Okay, coming to the first element and first part, record label. It contains data to identify the system type of record. So what kind of record it is, that is to identify type, whether it is books or monograph or journal or whatever it may be. Necessary for processing the record, such as total number of characters, length in the record, and the length and of various elements of record. So I told you already 24 character, that is the fixed length of this record label. It contains various submits and each have values according to the records. It has various subunits, that means subpart, subsystem, subparts, and everyone, every and every subpart has separate values according to the type of the record, right? See, this is a data of a record label. See, this all the number constitute to 24. These are the subunits of record label. So the record length is of 5 characters. The status is of 1 character. Blank means there is a space. And bibliographical level, blank, indicator length, subfield. So these are the subfields of record label. So 24 characters are there. This is the uniformity. You don't need to understand each and everything. You just, based on the number, you need to identify, yeah, this is record label, yeah, this is directory. Simple as that. You cannot remember each and every details. This is only for exchange purpose. Every bibliographical details about a record in stored is stored in this way only because so that it is easy to exchange. Okay, you just need to understand what are the parts. Simple as that. No need to understand each and every character, right? It will be very difficult. So similarly, directory contains content designator. It designates what the content is about for each data field followed by an indication of the position, right? So as I told earlier, it consists of 5 parts, right? So tag, length of the data field, starting character position, segment identifier, occurrence identifier. So these are the 5 major parts of directory. When we see the example, you will definitely understand, okay? So don't confuse with this new terminologies, okay? So again, these are the 5 parts. What is a tag? It is a 3 character code. Tag consists of 3 characters identifying the data field which corresponds to the direct entry. Length of the data field, it is a 4 digit number showing how many characters occupy the data field. Actually, so tag identify the data fields and length, the length of the data field says how many characters are occupied by the data field. That is a 4 digit number. It is a 4 digit number showing the characters that are occupied by the data field. Starting character position is, it's a 5 digit number giving the position of the first character of the data field relative to the base address of the data. That is nothing but the first character of the data field. So don't confuse about this. I'm telling it again because these terminologies might sound very new to you. Okay, when you see the example, you might be able to understand. In the broader context, remember that ISO is a common standard. ISO 2709 is a common standard for exchanging bibliographical information. If you understand that, it will be very easy and relevant to understand these subparts. Okay, segment identifier, a single character, occurrence identifier, how many times it has occurred, multiple occurrences of the data field that carry same within the same record segment. So see, this is the structure of a directory. It will be like this only. Tag, 5 parts, tag, length of data field, starting character position, segment identifier, occurrence identifier. See, and we will see this when we see this example. So 5 parts, this directory consists of 5 parts. So again, coming to the third part is data field. It is a variable length portion of the particular category of data associated with one entry in the directory. The last component are the forms and content of the data elements according to the cataloging rules. Okay, so data field is the length portion of the data associated with one entry and one directory. That indicates the length portion of the data. The last component is based on the cataloging rules, whatever cataloging rules, right? So this is the structure of data field. It has indicators, subfield identifier, subfield and field separator. So this is how a data field will look like. Record separator is the final character. That is the last character of the record. It follows a field separator on the final data field of a record. As I told earlier, it is a single character. See, this is an example of record label. First one. See, the top one, this is an example. So 00101A_M-22000067-452. So this is an example of what you call record label. It contains all the elements. You don't see any title of the book or anything. This particular information is a standard format. Okay, about the record label. See, that is a split up of what it stands for, right? So 00101 stands for total number of characters in the record. Okay, whatever record it may be, the characters, for example, I am simply saying I have written a book, right? I have written a journal paper of 3000 words that contains, when you type a paragraph in Word, you just in the left hand side you can see a word count and the character length. That is a character. Okay, there is 300 words in this paragraph, there is 500 characters in this paragraph. When you go to Word and type any paragraph, okay, any sentence, and you see the word count, there is 7 words and 10 characters, something like that. It includes the blank spaces are also included in the characters. That means this number, this particular concept indicates that books contains this many characters. That is a uniform structure, right? So A, the word A determines record status. What is the status? It is a new record or an old record or whatever it may be. Hyphen is a blank space. I told you there should be a blank space, right, according to the standard. And M is the bibliographical level. It is a monograph, okay, or it is an article, whatever it may be. And again a blank space, two blank spaces. And 22 indicates that the data in each field other than 001 begins with a two character indicate and subfield with a two character identifier, right? So whatever information which is provided other than the 001 includes in 22. So it changes, this label is same, but the information changes. My book might have 500 characters, your book might have 300 characters, but when we are following the same structure of record label, right, when we follow the same structure, it is easy to import and exchange, simple as that. So don't get too confused with this, just go through and over a period of time you will be able to understand this. Okay, fine. So this is an example of directory. See the directory, how it looks like. So this is an example of directory. So 01 is a tag for the first field, and 0007 is the length. What is the length and occurrence of the field? So when you see an example, you will definitely understand. Okay, so this is the split up of the directory. It consists of an entry of each of the fields present in the record. Okay, so this is an example of data field. You see, this is an example of data field. A1 2 3 4 5 states what the data is, and that hash mark is a field separating the field, and 00 is an indicator, and at A is a subfield indicator, right? Jones is the data actually. So this Jones, the name Jones is actually the data, and at B is the subfield identifier. Okay, at B is the subfield identifier. Again, John here is the data, that is, this one is the data, and 00, John is the data, and 00 is an indicator, and again RTA is a subfield identifier, fruit is a data. This is how it splits up. This is an example of what the data field is. This is the tag for the first field. We saw the tag for the first field, right? So this is the data. So once we know what the data field is about, we can easily understand what the directory is all about, right? And this is an overall example how a label directory and the field looks like, data looks like. So content designator, represented in bibliographical formats by tag, indicator, and other subfield codes. Okay, tag is, as I told, 3-digit numerical value, and indicators is, it is indicating why they are used and for where they are used. Okay, appearing in the beginning of each field. Subfield codes is consists of two parts: subfield identifier and subfield code. A character proceeding with a subfield code. It's a dollar sign. It's usually represented in a dollar sign, right, in Unimark. Subfield code is a character preceding and identifying a subfield. For subfield, example, subfield A is a title proper in the title and the statement of responsibility. Okay, subfield A is given, is the title proper in the title. Okay, so what is the scope? What is the scope of IS 02709? Okay, it is an international standard, describe a generalized structure. Okay, as I told earlier, it is a standard used for exchanging bibliographical information. So this record label, data field, directory, and record separator, whatever it may be, right? So these are the general framework designed by ISO in the name of ISO 2709, right? So this is used to store the data in this particular format. So once we all the softwares are having inbuilt ISO 2009, so we won't able to see that in manual, right? So when you store a record, it will be stored in this particular format only, so that it facilitates exchange. So these are the different types of document. These are the different types of document you can exchange it. Books, resources, continuing resources, right? And publications, periodical, that are continuing resources. Computer files, maps, music materials, visual materials, mixed materials. So these are the things you can exchange using ISO 2709 standard. So advantages we already know. It provides small number of elements, data elements, which are recognized by all sector. So these 3-4 types of data elements, it can be used to transfer loads and loads of bibliographical information, right? So kindly go through these references for getting a broader understanding about this particular standard. So this is all about ISO 2709. Thank you.